this pulpit with sacredness and thanksgiving. Thank you for allowing me to handle your word. The Father has placed before me this awesome task of feeding these your people. And Lord, I stand today and say, Lord, without your assistance, I can't do anything. Ask you right now to fill this sanctuary with the Holy Spirit. And anything that might prevent the moving of your Spirit, take it away right now. Let your people be free, oh God. Bind up the evil one, that you might receive glory. For you are truly a great God, a majestic Father, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. So have your way with this preacher. Have your way in this place. And Father, somebody in this sanctuary needs salvation. Lord, let your Spirit move right now, that they may be touched by your hand and come crying, what must I do to be saved? Move, Holy Spirit, in this place. Have your way right now. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Today I want to preach from the subject, successful fathering. Successful fathering. I want to salute all the fathers in the house this morning.
Amen.
And want you to know I thank God for you. I don't apologize for the Holy Spirit. But it seems like on Mother's Day, the spirit is high.
Amen.
And on right. Father's Day, the pastor has a whole lot of work to do.
Sorry.
I don't know what I'm talking about.
Amen.
But I thank God for fathers anyhow.
Amen.
Matter of fact, I thank God I'm a father.
Yeah.
Both a biological father and also a spiritual father.
Yeah.
And all because of the goodness of God. Yeah. The first formal Father's Day was celebrated on this day, June 19th in 1910. It began in a place called Spokane, Washington, when a woman whose name is Sonora Dove heard a Mother's Day sermon at her church. In hearing the Mother's Day sermon, she wanted to honor her father. The because the father had raised six children all by himself. Because their mother had died. So Nora drew up a petition and presented it to the community and ministers and people, along with the YMCA, signed on to that petition. And then 1972, the then President of the United States, Richard Nixon, established Father's Day as a permanent national observance on the third Sunday in June. So we thank God for her work and for her vision, her tenacity to bring about a day that's so meaningful. Father's Day is a companion to Mother's Day. But what it does, it gives us an opportunity to celebrate the unique contributions that fathers have made to the well-being and development of their children and their families. And from the perspective of our faith tradition, we also remember that even if we do not have the benefit of a relationship with a biological father, we do have a spiritual Father who created every last one of us. And prayerfully, if you walk right, you'll find a spiritual Father here on earth. Thank God for a spiritual Father in heaven. We also thank God for a spiritual Father here on earth who have taken up the desire and the word to be a father to somebody and somebody's child. Our spiritual Father, God, intended each of us to exist with a sense of purpose, a sense of dignity, and a sense of self-worth. Further, like our biological Father, our spiritual Father looks out for us. Our spiritual Father provides for us. Our spiritual Father protects us. Yeah. And when he needs to, our spiritual Father even corrects us. Yeah. Yeah. So it's on this day that we worship God and encourage men that are biological or spiritual fathers to keep on pressing their way. God says, although we are living in difficult times, fathers, keep striving to reach your full potential. Yes. And make sure that God uses you to be a successful father. Yes. And this should be the goal of every father, whether biological or spiritual. We should desire to live for God before our children and live a life that constantly moves to reach all that God has desired for us to be. Glory. The Bible tells us that God desires to be a blessing to all fathers, especially those who walk in the faith. God has given us a role in life, and we can expect that we can grow in that role, but God always fulfills this promise. God is honest with us. God does not say that there will not be some disappointments along the way. For every adult experiences some disappointments. And if you show me someone who's never had a disappointment, I ask you to set the time for me and them to sit down and have a good dialogue. Every adult experiences some disappointments. Well, you see, growing up, we start out believing that we can achieve and do anything. But as we grow older and become more mature, we discover that not all of our dreams come true. When these letdowns come, unfortunately, we begin begin to wonder about the promises that God has made to us. And you may raise the question, why didn't God deliver what I so desperately wanted? Does it mean that God is not faithful? Because what I wanted, God did not do? That what I wished for did not happen? I want you to know on this Father's Day, whether they're father or mother, or male or female, that there's a difference between hope and hopes and dreams. A big difference between hopes and dreams. Wishes may or may not come true, for they are dependent upon many variables. There are things that can disturb your wishes. The weather might disturb you. You may wish to go on a picnic this afternoon and a thunderstorm might come through. Wishes have variables. But hope is a response of faith to a promise from God. And sometimes it may seem as if we're waiting for a long time, but I want you to know today that God always keeps his promise. No matter how long it might take, God always comes through. But what we need to do is to discern between our wishes and God's promises. For everything we wish for, God did not promise. God knows what's best for us. And sometimes our wishes might be more destructive than helpful. Well, as we mature, many of our wishes have to be set aside. But the good news is this. The promise of God, however, no matter how long they take, shall sustain us through all of our years. God's promises will keep us and sustain us all of our years. So James, the writer of this book, comes and writes to a group of people, believers in the midst of their suffering. They were a suffering people. Much of their suffering was in the form of persecution. These persons, having come to faith in Christ, were being ostracized and attacked. They were being attacked because one day they decided to make Jesus their choice. And may I put a point here for a minute? We don't sometimes seem to realize what a blessing it is to come to God's house and to say that we are Christians. In this culture, they were attacked because they told somebody that they were Christians. Because they practiced what Christianity stood for, they found themselves being persecuted. They became peasants. And tenants living on a sad place, a bad piece of land. And things got so bad, with violence raised up, and also rioting raised up, because of social and also economic problems. James writes to people on occasion in this midst. But James aids us in this writing by providing information that will enable us to be a successful father. And not only will it enable us to be a successful father, but for women, boys, and girls, it will enable us to be successful individuals. Now, some may wonder why God has not said certain things. But the truth is, God keeps no secrets. He describes life just as it is. We might not like it. We might not want to hear it. But God describes life just as it is. And God lets us know that in this life, that there are challenges that we are going to be confronted with in our desire to be a good, effective father or a good, effective person. He lets us know that the moment you open your mouth and declare, I'm going all the way with Jesus, you're going to experience some challenges. James calls them trials. And also in some translations, they're called as temptations. James says, every last one of us will be tried, every last one of us will be tempted. But James does something strange here. His first words about the suffering may very well have been taking his people by surprise. He told them to count it all joy that they were facing these circumstances. Count it all joy when you're being tried. Count it all joy when you're being tempted. When it seems like every time you try, something gets in your way, count it joy. He said, when it seems like every time you get by one temptation, another one comes, count it joy. For James realized that no matter how good we are, every last one of us shall be tempted by something. But James says, when temptations come, count it all joy. Well, how did James say such a thing? Here I am trusting God, and challenges come. Here I am trusting God, and temptations come. And James says, count it joy. Well, but James could say this because he had a firm conviction that their temptations were not meaningless. It was rather God's way of bringing them into spiritual maturity. James believed that when you are tried, all it is God bringing you into full maturity. If God didn't try us, God would not be maturing us. Well, we look at these verses. James says something here. He says, to handle these temptations, to handle these trials, you need wisdom, you need prayer, and you also need faith. The Christians that James was addressing were facing many trials, many kinds of trials. And these trials were not necessarily serious persecution, but rather low-level persecution, such as social rejection or economic boycotts. In other words, they were boycotted against because of the poverty they were experiencing. They were rejected because they were not like the world, but they were Christians. And you and I know that the moment Jesus becomes your Lord, you'll find rejection. If you have not experienced rejection somewhere, it's time for a spiritual checkup. Well, they were facing these trials, the tribulation. But these were happening because they were Christians. Although these trials were painful, James called the believers to rejoice. Not because pain is pleasant. I don't know about you, but I don't enjoy pain. And I don't get happy when I get pain. But he says rejoice because they have a perspective that looks beyond the present and looks towards the future. The reason why they can rejoice is that the testing of their faith will produce patience, and patience is an important Christian value. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. And one thing one must gain along this journey in being a child of God, you must develop a sense of patience. Everything does not happen overnight. Sometimes it seems like you've been waiting for a long time. But God is developing patience in you. Patience and raising your children. Patience with your loved ones. Patience with your friends. Patience with the world. God is developing our patience. Well, it's important to note something here. James did not say that a believer will be joyous for the trial of temptation. But he said, in the trials and temptations, we should be joyous. That's the big difference. I have a problem with anyone who loves to feel pain. I have a problem with someone who doesn't find joy sometimes. But James says, in the midst of your trial, have joy. And the joy comes in knowing that no matter what the day may bring, the God who holds tomorrow is the God who holds you by your hand. And if God woke you this morning, God will take you through. That's good while you're in the pain. God will take you through the pain. That's why those with the bunch of faith will sometimes, in the midst of challenges, will still have a smile on their face. They do so because they know that while I'm being challenged, the God I serve is still in control. And he will surely come through. They can smile because they know that weeping only joys for a moment. But joy comes in the morning. They can smile because they know that deep down within, that he who holds tomorrow is the one who holds them by their hand. James calls them to rejoice in the midst of it. Sometimes God will give you an assignment that seems too big for you. And when you feel a little overwhelmed by it, it's helpful for us to remember that God will enable us to complete the assignment. Because in doing so, God keeps his promise. Although it may seem like a major thing, God has promised to give you the strength and the knowledge to work through it. And because he's promised, he also keeps his promise. And God will come through. So James says, you will be challenged. That's why I don't look very far from there to be sunny day. The challenges in the life. But James says, in the midst of your challenge, don't walk with your head hung down, but lift it up and rejoice. And be glad. But again, he goes on, he says, so success to live as a father or as a person. Striving to reach your full potential. That we are in need of something. And one thing believers need, but there's one thing we lack, and that is wisdom. No matter how much wisdom we have, we can always use some more. I said a number of times in this pulpit, I'm afraid of folks who know everything. Because when the danger comes, they might be the first one to realize they don't know anything. He says, but always use more wisdom. And it particularly requires wisdom to see trials as a blessing. To see trials as a blessing, it takes wisdom. So someone raised the question, Pastor Johnson, what is wisdom? And wisdom must not be confused with knowledge. Yes. Amen. Knowledge is information. And wisdom is application. Knowledge is comprehending the facts. Wisdom is handling life. Knowledge is theoretical. But wisdom is practical. And what I'm saying is, you can be blessed to know a number of things and don't have wisdom. For wisdom tells you how to use what you know. And if you know something and don't know how to use that something, you find yourself living a life of failure. Wisdom enables us to do it. Wisdom is also an important biblical word. When Bible language, it means more than intellectual knowledge. Yes. Wisdom is less knowing than knowing how. Yes. You know, knowledge is knowing the Bible. Yes. Yes. Wisdom is knowing how to live according to the Bible. Yes. The difference between the two. The biblical language, it implies a skill in living that is passed down from parent to child and has its ultimate source in God. Yes. My parents, they gave us one thing. They gave us wisdom, and they gave us character. And they passed it down to us because they knew if we were going to survive, we would need it. Well, there was some books of the Bible, the book of Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, and Job. They say the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. That means to love God is the beginning of wisdom. If you haven't found out how to love God, you don't have wisdom. Wisdom is loving God. They're going to say, and Proverbs encourages us to always be turning your ear towards wisdom and applying your heart to understand. Another one in the Proverbs says, for the Lord gives wisdom, and from his mouth comes knowledge and understanding. James says we need to have wisdom. And James says because we need it, we need to ask God for it. There's no shame in telling God there's some things you can't figure out. Lord, I read the manual, but I still can't put the thing together. Grant me your wisdom. And because we ask God for it, God gives wisdom generously. Yeah. The word used here in translation means straightforward. That when God gives us wisdom, he gives us wisdom with those strings attached. Yeah. Yeah. But the important thing he says, in the eighth verse, he says, unlike the double-minded man. Now let me stay here for a second. That's the reason why a song will give you some knowledge. To use you rather than bless you. So some will give you some knowledge with some strings attached because they want to control you. But God says, I don't want to control you. I want you to be blessed. I want you to be saved. I want you to be successful. I give you wisdom with no strings attached. Well, God is not in doubt about giving. God has no ulterior motives. He gives without hesitation. And without regard to our worthiness, he gives to our all. As a matter of fact, some of the wisdom God gives us, we don't even deserve. We turn our back on him. We walk away from him. But in spite of it, God still gives us wisdom. And the good news is this. Unlike humans, God has no fingers. Amen. Some folks will grant wisdom to who they want to have wisdom. And y'all know I'm telling the truth. But God says, no matter who you are, where you were born, what your financial situation is, if you ask me for wisdom, I will grant it to you. He also gives without finding fault. I'm so glad that God does not find fault in us and say, I will not grant you wisdom. But God says today that although there may be a fault in you, I'll still grant you wisdom, but once you get wisdom, you stop doing what you've been doing. He gives us wisdom with no fault. But like a generous father, is eager to give wisdom to those who ask. And the truth is, when we think about our prayer life, we ask God for finance. We ask God for material things. We ask God for healing. But how many times do we ask God for wisdom? If we ask God for wisdom, some of the stuff we deal with, we will not have to deal with. For God will have already given us wisdom to deal with those situations. James says, ask God for wisdom. Yeah. And he will grant it to him. But he also goes on to say that when you ask him for wisdom, and when you ask him to keep his promises that he has already made, ask him in faith. Yeah. What faith does, faith keeps your hopes fresh and lively. Without faith, your hope is like a burned up piece of ash. But when you have hope connected with faith, you can sing, "My faith looks up to thee, thou Lamb of Calvary." For your faith will put your hopes in balance when the world is the other balance. I don't know how you feel today. Of all the crazy stuff going on in the world, if I didn't have faith in God, I would wonder what tomorrow's going to bring. Now, whether you agree the lifestyle or not, there's no reason or right for anyone to take out of here 50 people's lives. There's no reason for a baby to be destroyed by an alligator. There's no reason for 5 kids to be shot right here in Wilmington. I have to have hope. I have my hope based on my faith. I believe that God is still in control. I believe God will still take care of you. My faith tells me my hope is in Christ Jesus, and through that he will come through. Well, the chief grace, let's try to hear it. But when James talks about trials and temptation, the chief grace that's tried in persecution is your faith. Yes. Satan hates faith.
Amen.
For Satan knows that when he tempts you, your faith will keep you from yielding to the temptation. Everything. Satan knows. Yes, from the pulpit to the door, all of us will face trials and temptation. And Satan knows if I can mess with their faith, I've got them and they'll be my child rather than God's child. He don't dislike faith, he hates faith. And that's why he'll make your faith burn low when you're trying to be strong. But while Satan hates faith, God delights in our faith. For faith in God is perfection. God says, if they believe that much in me, I've got to come through. God says, if they had that faith in me, let me show them what I can do. Not just something, but I can do all things because of their faith. Well, unfortunately, faith is tried. Because it's the life of a Christian. But back it says that the righteous shall live by faith. Yeah. That means, therefore, those of us who proclaim to be children of God, we should walk daily by faith.
Yes.
I know these evil times, but you should not go to sleep tonight worrying about tomorrow. You should not worry about your good night's sleep. Your faith shall have you singing all day, all night. Angels keep watching over me. Your face to tell me in the morning when I rise up, I will have no doubt. Your face will tell you to say, there is a bright side somewhere. I'm going to keep on marching until I find it. But just to live by faith. Not just faith every now and then, but faith in the good times. Faith in the bad times. Faith in the hard times. Just to live by faith. Well, we broke by love, but we live by faith. But even one tests our faith because he knows that faith that's tested. There's a grace that must be exercised. Sometimes keeping the soul from evil actions. You exercise your faith. It's almost like a bodybuilder lifting a weight. The strength of the muscles.
Yes.
When you exercise your faith, you exercise your relationship with God.
Yes.
If you tell the truth,
yeah.
When trials come and temptations come, Satan always wants to whisper in your ear.
Yes. Yes.
If I were you, I'd give up.
Yes.
If I were you, I wouldn't try that. He's just testing your faith. And hoping you'll give in. But I thank God that God whispers in the other ear. and says, remember who woke you this morning. Oh yeah, remember who put clothes on your back. Remember who's been keeping you. And when you hear his voice, you will surely come through. And because you believe, believer makes the soul withstand a trial. Sometimes our faith is exercised to bring the soul to live on the gospel. The saints of God, brothers and sisters, even in 2016, we must live according to the gospel.
Yes.
The book has not changed.
Amen.
We may have new methods of exercising, but the book is still the same.
Yes.
This is still our Father's word.
Yes.
God is still in charge.
Yes.
God will rule and super rule. Yes. But James reminds us, if we're going to be successful fathers or successful children of God, there's something you must understand. He says you've got to understand that you will be challenged in this life.
Yes.
I thank God. I don't love it, but I thank God for my challenges.
Yes.
When I go through my challenges, I find God always comes through.
Yes.
And if I did not have a challenge, I would know what God can do.
Yes.
He said, remember this challenge of life? He said, ask God for wisdom to deal with it. And not only must you ask God for wisdom, but along with asking for wisdom, you must serve him in faith.
Yes.
And if you practice these fundamentals,
yes.
God, through James, has laid out for us, he tells us also in that passage that we will live without mourning. The child of God who practices wisdom, who marches on by faith, will not have to want for anything. Oh, it might not arrive when you want it, but it's on the way. Every child of God has their day. It might not be your day today, but thank God, if I live, there's a tomorrow. It might not be mine right now, but thank God, there's a better day. And I don't know about you, but I believe God. I take God at his word. So therefore, as I raise my children, as I pastor this church, I want to be a faithful father. I can't do it by myself, but I've got somebody who shows me how, teaches me how, walks with me, talks with me. God is my father. I'll serve him until I die. I promise him that I will follow till I die. And when God takes me home, somebody will know, yes, I may have been a hard father, but I'm a faithful father. I may have been a strong father, but I'm a faithful father. God has led me to practice wisdom, prayer, and also my faith. And because of that, then I can say, my faith looks up to thee. This prayer time now, I'm going to ask all the fathers in the house come in the hour, the altar first. All the fathers come first. As you come also to challenge you, fathers, walk as the Lord would have you walk before your children. Your children will walk like you, talk like you, act like you. And it's hard to try to turn them around. But if you walk before them as God wants you to, God will bless your children. Amen, somebody. God will bless this generation and make it a brand new generation. But we must lead them. Don't just tell them, but lead them as we walk before them. Make me pray. Dear God, I come right now. In the name of Jesus. And I present these fathers who stand before me. First of all, dear Lord, thanking you for them. For assigning them responsibility of being a father to a household. I pray to God that you will use them to be living examples that those who may want to know something about you will find you living inside of them. I pray, God, that you make them responsible fathers and help them realize that they are accountable to you. I pray for their children and grandchildren, of God, that they may see you living inside of them. And that their grandsons and granddaughters will want to be like you because they saw Christ in my granddad and my dad. And through the efforts of God, that they may turn this community upside down. I pray for your grace right now. I pray for your mercy right now. And oh God, I pray, oh God, that you will crown their head with wisdom. Lord, you gave them knowledge. Now, Lord, please give them wisdom that they may know how to use the knowledge that I was given them. If there be any sick among them, I pray for your healing right now. For one touch from you will make everything all right. Lord, if they're weak, make them strong. If they have something they're struggling with, you are a deliverer. Deliver them right now. Lord, take out hatred, take out jealousy, take out backbiting, and place it with Jesus the Christ. Lord, sanctify them in your will, in your way. I know that you can. I believe that you will. I pray for these men that when they leave here today, they will tell somebody, I spent some time with Jesus. I've been to the house of the faith. I shared my faith with somebody. I'm going out to turn the world upside down. If you did it for Matthew, if you did it for Peter, if you did it for John, Lord, you can do it for them. Lord, do it for them right now. I place them in your hand. Pray for your sanctification. Pray for your strength as you concentrate and deal with them. Help them now to receive you as a gift that otherwise they might not receive. Bless them, oh God. In Jesus Christ's name I pray. Amen. 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 And thank God.
Just the years of your life.